We greet you in the precious mighty name of Jesus. Thank you for turning up today. We welcome all of you. Thank you for coming. Amen.
Amen.
Our grand sons from Nairobi welcome you. Angel, welcome.
Angel,
everyone of you, welcome. Thank you for coming. Wow. You are finally home, right?
Eh?
Amen. Let's clap for them and make them feel welcome. Amen. Pastor David, many thank you for coming.
Pastor David, you are welcome.
Pastor Wayne, thank you for coming.
Pastor Wayne.
And everyone of you. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Maybe some, it was there. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord.
Yes, he is.
So welcome you here at Kingdom Life Tabernacle.
To one of Kingdom Life Tabernacle.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord.
Yes, he is.
Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Just touch on the button and tell them your expectation.
Tell them.
Tell them what you expect.
They're
not talking, please tell
them. What
do you expect today?
And
then tomorrow. And then the other day, and then on Thursday, and then on Friday,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord.
Yes,
I said, Jesus is Lord. I said, Jesus is Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Welcome to Kingdom Life Tabernacle. Our vision here is to grow God's people into spiritual maturity, that they may be able to manifest Kingdom Life on this
planet.
Our mission is fivefold. Identify, train, equip, commission, and cause you to occupy. And our core values are also fivefold. Christ-like character, purity and holiness, integrity, accountability, and above all excellence. So welcome you in our 7th Empowerment Summit in the mighty name of Jesus. Those of you that are following us on
live streaming,
we also welcome you in the name of Jesus. Wherever you are watching us from, we welcome you. And please, we encourage you, late as many as possible, to follow us. All our dear followers, all there from Canada, from US, from Dubai, from Qatar, from Egypt, from Scotland, from South Africa, and Botswana, please, we love you in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We have come at a wonderful time to receive God's word that is going to take us through the entire year. Before God does anything, He has to speak His word first. Right from Genesis through Revelation, there's nothing God has ever done before speaking His word, before saying His word. In the name of Jesus, somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's open our Bibles in the book of Samuel. Chapter 3 and verse 19. Samuel chapter 3 verse 19. The Bible says, and Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him. And he did let none of his words fall to the ground. None of the word was let to fall down during Samuel's time. My prayer today is, none of the word you receive this week will fall down on the ground before impacting and affecting you. And the Bible says that all Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was established to be a prophet of the Lord. The word that God is sending to us this week will not fall on the ground. But besides that, the word is being sent to establish us. You are here to be established in your destiny. You are here to be established in God's purposes concerning your life. And as a means of achieving that, that's why God is sending His word. Verse 21, and the Lord appeared again in Shalom. For the Lord he revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord. We are here this week for the word of God to be revealed to us. God has called us upon this mountain to release His word, to establish us, and to cause us to accomplish His purpose concerning our
lives.
Because nothing God will ever attempt to do before He sends His word. Bible teaches us in Hebrews chapter 1 that the world we have flamed by the word. Everything came in existence by the word. So it is important that we give attention to the word, and I know we came here to receive the word. So we better raise up our expectations, because expectation is the breeding ground, like one man said, for any miracle. It is what we expect that in return God gives to us. What you never expect, you never be able to receive from God. It is an expectation that provokes the intervention of God. I pray that you open up your heart and your spirit to be expectant from the Lord. In the name of Jesus. I want to begin by a way of introducing our theme for this summit or for this year. The theme is kingdom application to glorification. Kingdom application for glorification. Can you talk to someone and tell them kingdom application for to glorification? Can you say it louder? Kingdom application,
kingdom application
to glorification. Can you shout it louder? Kingdom application,
kingdom application
to glorification.
Glorification.
Can you say it 7 times? 1, 2, 3, begin.
Kingdom application to glorification.
2.
Kingdom application to glorification.
3.
Kingdom application to glorification.
4.
Kingdom application.
5.
Kingdom application to glorification.
6.
Kingdom application to glorification.
Now loudest, 7.
Kingdom application to glorification.
We are on this mountain this week.
Sorry, for the week, you know.
Trying to understand the mind of God for the time and the season as this. God is a God that moves in times and seasons. And we need to understand what he has to say in a particular season and in a particular moment. As far as this mountain is concerned, God is desirous of us to learn on how to apply his kingdom in order to be able to attain a measure of glory that will magnify his name. Creation was created to reveal and to manifest the glory of God. We were not created or designed to live below his glory. We were designed to manifest, to declare, to demonstrate God's glory. That is the purpose of our existence. When we read Psalms 19, this is what the Bible says, that the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttered speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech, no language where their voice is not heard. Their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words the end of the world. In them has he set tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of this chamber, and rejoices as a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heavens, and it's centered unto the ends of it. And there's nothing hid from the heat thereof. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul, and the testimony of the Lord is sure, making the way simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. Who can understand his error? Cleanse thou me from my secret faults. Keep back thy servant from presumptuous things, and let them not have dominion over them. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. Let the words of thy mouth, let the words of my mouth, and the conversation might have.
No, for me, it's
acceptable.
Because the way.
And I said, oh Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Blessed be the word of the Lord. That psalm begins by showing us the need of his glory. And the reason why the entire heaven and earth were created. The purpose of you and me were created was to reveal, to manifest, and to demonstrate his glory. That's why when we live a life below the glory, it is a stressful life, is a boring life, is a miserable life. And we are not designed to function that way. You are not designed to function in poverty. Human beings are not designed to function in sicknesses and diseases. The cause of stress and depression is because of our malfunctioning. We were created and designed to enjoy glory, to reveal glory, to manifest glory. And that is basically what we call a kingdom kind of life. God does not want us to enjoy kingdom life after we have come out of life. It is his desire that his kids, his children will enjoy the reality of kingdom life while they are still on earth.
He
said that those people that are not in the Lord, when they look at us, they can be able to admire us and also envy us. But when we look at the state of the children of God today, is a bit appealing and alarming and a little bit disgraceful. The people of the world kind of look better, stronger, a little bit glorious than we are, and okay, it's just honest, a deception, and then yet that's how they're supposed to be. But I trust God this year, God will help to unveil you. God will help your star to shine. God will help your radiance to appear. God will cause you to show up. And when you show up, his glory will be manifested. My task at this hour, as you officially open up this summit, is trying to help us to understand the statement of applying the kingdom of God to glorification. So for us to be able to live the life we are supposed to live, there is a requirement of an application. There is a requirement of an enforcement. Until we apply, we cannot see. Until we engage, we cannot be able to see. Until we intentionally enforce the kingdom of God, we cannot be able to reveal his glory. So I want to talk about what does it mean to, when we say kingdom application, or what does it mean to apply the kingdom. First of all, why kingdom? When God created man in Genesis, he created a kingdom for him. In Genesis chapter 1 verse 28, 26 to 38, man was created for the kingdom, and that is God's original plan for mankind, for man to rule and to reign on earth as a king and as a priest. But when man fell short of God's glory, in Genesis chapter 3, we are aware that man lost the kingdom. Trouble started coming in man, in the race of man. We see actually 7 major calamities that came in human race, which are still affecting man until today. Those calamities are in Genesis chapter 3. Let's just highlight them. When man lost the kingdom, these calamities held this man. And Jesus first came back to address these calamities so that he may restore the kingdom back to us. So every time we are moving outside God's kingdom, these calamities will always be patent and live in our life. Number one calamity we see in Genesis chapter 3 verse 7. After the fall of man, nakedness appeared on the face of the earth. Man lost the glory of God, and he came up with self-made glories of leaves made by the hands of men. When he lost the glory, nakedness is symbolic to emptiness. Nakedness is symbolic to shame and disgrace. Nakedness basically reveals the shame nature. So from that time until tomorrow, man is still suffering this fate. You see, when you are naked, you are not sure of who you are. When you are naked, you have low self-esteem. All these ladies we see on the street, literally walking half naked, is an indicator that they have low or poor self-esteem. When you know who you are, when you understand your true identity in Christ, you don't have to wear a miniskirt, or you don't have to put your breast to be exposed, because you are sure of who you are. Mwatu wewe kakasa chichori, teweza kakena nge vitundwe mwatu obioleseza wewa, wewe kakasa chori, mwomani chori mkwe. So number two calamity that fell upon man when he lost the kingdom, akabata mwoku liakabwa kumwane omu, mwabaka wakabumushitu wako, is in verse 14. Tono sama mnyole kuminenya. The first time we see the word curse appearing in the race of human beings.
Awutandilo mrawe chigambo,
curses came, land was cursed, the serpent was cursed, and cursed began to affect everything that God created. When the kingdom is not at work, curses will have an effect on the human race. When the kingdom is at work, curses will go away and the blessing will come in. Number three. Calamity that befell man when he lost the kingdom is in verse 16. For the first time in the history of the Bible, we see the word is sorrow. Sorrow has to do with grief. Sorrow has to do with pain. Sorrow has to do with anxiety. Sorrow has to do with fear. Sorrow has to do with depression. Sorrow has to do with anxiety. Every time we live outside God's kingdom, we become victims of sorrow. And that's not part of the kingdom life you're supposed to enjoy. Calamity number four that fell upon the race of man when he lost the kingdom is found in Genesis chapter 19. For the first time we see the word known as sweat. Sweating is a curse. Sweating is not God's design for mankind. I believe in hard work. But hard work does not tantamount to sweating. Sweating actually is a result of a curse of a man. We are not supposed to make ends meet by sweating. Actually, it is indicated in the book of Ezekiel that a priest was instructed never to wear apparels made with wool. They were made only to wear garments made out of linen. The reason why priests are not meant to wear wool, because wool would generate sweating. So we are not supposed to sweat in the presence of God. We are supposed to be blessed and to enjoy the blessings of the Lord without sweating. Because in the kingdom, it's not by power, neither by might, but it is by the Spirit of the Lord. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Calamity number what?
Number
five. Calamity number five. We see the word is sworn for the first time in the scriptures. Sworn in the scriptures. When Adam was cast, in verse 24, we see the word sword appearing for the first time in the scriptures. Now, sword is symbolic to battles.
It's
symbolic to bloodshed.
It's
symbolic to fighting one another.
It's
symbolic to wars and battles. Destroying one another. So laws of the kingdom introduced wars, battles, fighting one another, terminating each other's
life.
When we live in the kingdom, that is taken care of. No more fighting each other. No more fighting one another. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout a bigger hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Can I get another one? Number six. Calamity number six is barrenness. When the kingdom is lost, the human race will suffer barrenness of all sorts and all forms. Verse 18, we see the word barrenness for the first time in the scriptures. Barrenness attracts poverty. Barrenness attracts misery. Barrenness attracts unfruitfulness. Barrenness has to do with dryness. has to do with lack of effectiveness. So bias has to do with not having enough. Bias has to do with working on emergency. Bias has to do with everything is not enough. Bias has to do with living in scarcity or under scarcity. Bias has to do with lack. Things are not enough.
So
every time we are outside God's kingdom, we live in that kind of state. But the moment we live in the kingdom, begin to enjoy the reality of abundance. We begin to enjoy the reality of increase. So that is what came to mankind. When he lost the kingdom. Calamity number 7 that befell the race of man when he lost his kingdom is known as death. Both physical death and spiritual death. Man was not meant to die. He was meant to live like his papa, King of Glory. To live forever. But when he lost the kingdom, he lost the engine of life. And man started surviving and struggling. Man started gambling with life. He started struggling with the uncertainty of the future. Not sure how long when he will be able to live. Not sure of his future. He lost hope for the future. But when we get into the kingdom, we are sure of our future. We are sure of our hope. We are not afraid of death, because as a matter of fact, we are already dead in Christ. And we live inside of him. So that is the reason why we need to put an emphasis on the kingdom. The reason why Christ came. He didn't just come to save mankind. I have often said, salvation is only plan B for mankind. Actually, salvation is just an emergency kit for mankind. Salvation actually is just a resuscitator of man's life. But that's not the entire why Christ came. Salvation is just a means to help us to go back to the original intent. Salvation is the means. Yes. To take us back to the original plan. Now the challenge is, for many years the church has so much concentrated on salvation. That's why there are many people upon again who are saved but frustrated, but they are as poor as a mosque mouse. People are saved, but they are born in salvation. People are saved, but they are not living right. People are saved, but they are not enjoying the joy of salvation. People are saved, but their lifestyle is not changing. Why? Because many have stopped at the salvation level. They have not gone to a level of seeking the kingdom and his righteousness. So salvation is the means to the kingdom. Salvation is the first step to the kingdom. Jesus said in John chapter 3 verse 3. John chapter 3 verse 3. Jesus said these words. John chapter 3 verse 3, not Genesis. The Gospel of John. Chapter 3. Jesus said these words. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, except a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So salvation enables us to see the kingdom of God. Salvation enables us to see his kingdom. But it does not enable us to enjoy
the kingdom.
So salvation is only a means that introduces us to the kingdom. So many have stopped at the salvation stage. Many have stopped at the born again stage. And that's why the kingdom is not given a priority. So many have seen the kingdom, but they have not enjoyed it. Give us verse 5. The same chapter. Verse 5, the Bible says, Jesus now answered, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Now the first one is to see. When we get born again, we see. We see what God has to say. We see the glory of God. But the second one, when we engage, when we apply, when we enforce, that is when we are able to enter. Many of us have not entered. We are still outside the kingdom of God. How do I know? Our physical life, the way of our life does not reflect it.
Right.
Ask your neighbor, are you inside or you are outside? Ask your neighbor, are you in or you are out? Are you in or out? Now ask them if they are in or if they are out. Ask them what is the proof. The proof that we are in is the life that flows out of us. Am I talking to someone? So that is why Jesus came to use salvation as a means to help us to connect to the kingdom. And when he came, actually Jesus, never preached born again. Actually, he talked about born again once. And we are busy emphasizing born again all the time. We are busy emphasizing salvation. Jesus talked about salvation once. But the greatest time of this moment of teaching, he talked about the kingdom of God. John came preaching the kingdom. Matthew chapter 3 verses 1 to 2. John was moving by the Bible declares that in those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea. Verses to the Bible says, and saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. After repentance, after salvation, we need to put an emphasis on the kingdom. After we have repentance, because partly salvation has to do with repent, then we must put emphasis on the kingdom. Still, when Jesus comes,
yes,
in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, Jesus said, from that time,
yes,
Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. God is mindful about his kingdom to be restored on earth. We need to keep attention to God's kingdom, because that way the glory of the Lord is manifested. When we go to Matthew chapter
6,
the disciples were a little bit concerned about the life of prayer. And Matthew chapter
6
and verse 7, Jesus is telling them.
Yes, Abagamba.
He's telling them.
Abagamba.
But when you pray, use not vain repetitions, as the heathens do.
Agamanenge musaba. Temudingana bigambo ngabala
we bakwa. For they think that they shall be heard of their much speaking.
Wangabala woza ndibanawulirwa nyo okudingana ngako bigambo byabo.
Be not yet therefore be like them. For your Father knoweth which things ye have need of before ye ask. After this manner therefore pray ye. Our Father which art in heaven, allow be thy name, thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is heaven. In this segment of prayer, Jesus is showing us a mode of prayer and telling us that in our daily prayer, we must include his kingdom to come. In every prayer point, we must indicate his kingdom. We must be cautious of his kingdom, because that is why we are here, to manifest the kingdom kind of life. So God's number one interest is that the earth experiences the reality of his kingdom amongst us. Our passion, our desire, our interest, our pursuance, our focus, our main agenda should be about his kingdom. Kingdom influence must be in every sector of life. Kingdom influence must be among us all the seven spheres of influence. Until that is done, God does not need any one of us to leave this earth. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, after having said that, therefore, for us to be able to manifest kingdom life, we need application. We need to apply the kingdom. And let me make a few statements before we define what application is. A few principles I've noted here have said that until intentional application is in applying, until we intentionally apply the kingdom, we cannot manifest it.
Obutuusa nga tukigenderedde ne tumalirira okuteeka mu nkola obwakabaka tusobola kwoleza.
We need to be intentional in applying the kingdom in order to manifest it.
Bw'oba oyagala bulabisibwe, oteeka okuteekako essira n'omalirira okulaba ng'obuteeka mu nkola, olina okukigenderera.
In whatever we do, we must be intentional in applying the kingdom.
Oteeka okukola n'obugenderevu ng'omalirira ng'ogenderera okulaba nti okiteeka mu nkola kisobola okulabisibwa.
Number two.
Ekyokubiri.
Kingdom manifestation in every area of our lives is the number one reason of our existence on earth. You don't exist, you are not existing to give birth to kids or to buy more cars or to build more houses.
Tori mulamuko no kuzala bana bangi kulukoku muri kugula moto kana bizimbe nedda.
But you exist to manifest the kingdom of God in every area of your life.
Na Yesu ngalwachi bakulekera omukoko sota mulobeyo osoro kuchikirira eguru lili olirage oliolese wano.
Because that is how the glory of God is revealed.
Which is what akatonda bwekirabisibwa.
You are here to give God glory that may give it back to you.
Oli wano okwolesa kitiibwa kya Katonda asobole okikuddiza.
When God is glorified,
wagulumizibwa,
you get glorified.
Now
Jesus said in John chapter 17,
Yesu yagamba mungire ya Yohana
17, Father, I have glorified you.
Kitange kugulumiza.
Glorify your son.
Nawe kugulumiza omutabani wo.
When you glorify God,
kugulumiza tata.
In return you get glorified.
Nawe techeka ni
how do you glorify God?
Omugulumiza otya?
By manifesting the kingdom kind of life.
Ngobulamu obwo bwakabaka obwolesa eri ensi.
When people look at your good life,
abantu batunobulamu bwobulungi,
they will praise the name of the Lord.
Bajja kutendereza erinnya lya Mukama.
Let me give you probably an example.
Kankuwa ekyokulabirako.
I grew in a dysfunctional family.
Nakulira mu maka nga siri wamu ne taata na maama.
I didn't have a chance to grow with, I never got an opportunity to go with my mom and my dad.
Safu na mukisa ukula ni tanda ni mama nga bombi bali mukaso yaka mu.
I lived with my dad. Yes, I remember one year when I was joining primary one.
Na bila ko ni kitani nzikira ko munyi gumunga nyingira P1.
After that I began to stay with the relatives, uncle, auntie, grandpa, grandwa.
Awo natambula ngale rino sulake wa kojja liye wasenga liye wajjaji omuntu gote ngatambula we.
Eventually I was a teenager. I desired to see my dad. I went to my mom and asked where my dad was. And she directed me. I took a bus. It's about 1.5 hours or 2 hours. Eventually I got to see my dad. As a teenager. We had a moment with him. So time came and I wanted to leave to go back to school where I used to stay. I went to him for school fees and for resources. I wouldn't love to say what he told me. But it was very hurting. I left the presence of my father as a disgruntled young man.
Life vowed
never to look to that man again. I hated him with passion. But after a while, the word of the Lord came to me and I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and personal Savior. Of course, I forgave him and I let go. And I moved on. He moved on too. Many years later, when I joined ministry and now I was serving the Lord
after school,
I would often go and visit him where I stayed. This time he had lost his job, he was not leading a good life. Once in a while, I would take him an envelope, I would take him stuff. Do a bit of some shopping, clothes, shoes, stuff. But I learned when the moment I would leave, he would go and sell off what I bought him, and then he would go into a bar and
I discovered actually I was about to kill my father.
Somebody shouts hallelujah.
God coming.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, after a couple of years, I discovered he was not living a good life. So I chose to make a decision to pick him from where he was staying to get him a better place. So I talked to my older brother. We made an arrangement and we got him a house that was close to my older brother. And I told him every month I'll be able to remit him some money so that they can be able to take care of his rent and also his upkeep. And we did that by the grace of God. So every month we'd send something to him for his housing and also his
apartment.
I did that for about 5 years or so. So eventually, I learned that we were very sick. We did whatever we could, and eventually could not survive. He passed on. So when he died, they told me Mzee has died. I said, fine, let me see what we are able to do. Of course, they had kept the body at the hospital because of the hospital bill. I told them, no, keep the body until I come. Because I wanted to get a funeral car and funeral service guys from Kampala to go with them. It's a process, you have to go through a few things. I told them, wait for me until we come with an ambulance. So went clear whatever we're supposed to clear. And then went to the hospital. And of course the funeral service took over. We did whatever we're supposed to do. Now when we get in the village where we're supposed to bury him, the entire family had sat with a budget. They were confused because they didn't know what to do with the budget. Actually, they were planning postponing even the burial because they thought they would get a bit of some fundraising here and there to be able to get money to put things together for the
burial.
So when I came, I told them, when is the date of burial? They said, we are not sure. I said, why? He said, because of money. So immediately I called a meeting. And when I called the meeting, I told them, please show me the budget. And they began to tell me, you see, we need this is so many kilos of sugar. I told them, but I've brought it back. And then we need this so many kilos of rice. I told them, actually, I have bought 2 bags of rice. They said, we need about 30 kilos of meat. I told them, can we be able to find a cow in the community? Now, within just 10 minutes, by the grace of God, I had handled the budget. And that was the end of the clearing meeting. When it came of making the grave, and we are to get the material, I told them, can you get me somebody and I pay? So I gave someone a contract to be able to handle all the things as far as construction of the grave and everything is concerned. I made sure that we give my father a glorious, dignified send-off. After the burial of my father, The body of my father became the talk of the entire village. The words went all around. Now my grandmother, the mother to my late dad, is still alive. She's over 100 years plus. She still no more understands everything. She was not able to attend that burial because of the pressure. She got pressure when she had her son was dead. But after burial, people went and told her what happened to the burial of her son. So she sent someone and said, please allow my grandson to come to me before he goes back. So late in the evening, after the burial and after we have seen people off, I went to the grandma. And she made a request to me. She said, my grandson, first of all, I want to thank you for the glorious sent off of my son who is your father. People have been telling me about this. But I also beg you, when I die, you must organize my burial arrangements. I said I have no problem with that. But it is Jesus that has done that.
And
only the vessel. So if you want the same, just allow Jesus to come your way. She said, what are you waiting for? To lead me to the Lord Jesus Christ. I love that Jesus. So the glorious send off of my father led my grandmother, who is over 100 years, to receive Christ as his Lord, as her Lord and Pastor. From that time, people change their attitude as far as Jesus is concerned. So that is why I said, until your glory is revealed, there are people that will never change. There are people that will never come to the Lord. Your life must have a difference.
Your life must have a
difference.
And
not difference. And deniable distance. So that's why I said kingdom manifestation must be a priority in every area of your life, because that is the purpose number one of your existence. Number three, I say, in the world where I plan the kingdom, both the king and the priest in you must be given liberty to find expression. In every child of God, there is both a king and a priest. So you must give liberty to the king in you to show up and the priest in you to show up. In Revelation chapter, of course, 1 and verse 6. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 6, the Bible says, he has made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So you and me have been made to be kings and priests. Therefore, we must give that king and that priest in you to come out. The Bible has said for glory and dominion. For glory and dominion. Revelation chapter 5 and verse 11. Revelation chapter 5 verse 11. The Bible says, and he has made us unto our God kings and priests. And we shall reign on earth. You have no choice except to reign and
rule.
You are meant, you are designed, you are destined to rule and to reign. That is the way of your glory to be manifested. You are meant to rule. You are meant to reign. You are meant to be in dominion. That way, the glory of God will be revealed upon your
life.
Am I talking to someone? Number four, I saw you are a king. So you must allow the king in you to come out and the priest out of you. Why the king? The king helps you to dominate the earth and the creation. The king aspect in you. The king side in you. It enables you to have dominion over creation. And the priest side of you enables you to connect with the supernatural. The priest side of you enables you to connect with the source. So it is the higher source, which is the supernatural, which is God, which is your divine connection that enables you to rule on earth and have governance on earth. No wonder Jesus said in Matthew 6:33,
take
my kingdom and my righteousness, and the rest of the things shall be added
unto
you. So the kingdom you are meant to seek is about the king, and the righteousness you are meant to seek is about the priest. So priesthood enters you into the righteousness of God. Kingdom enables you to enter into the kingship. And both of that represent the cross. That represents the message or the power of the cross. That's why Jesus comes in, I think in Matthew 16. He said, unless a man carry his cross, he can never be my disciple. Praise the name. Is that very key? Principle number four, kingdom application, therefore, is the gateway to glorification and exaltation in the game of life. Kingdom application is the gateway, is the entrance into glory and exaltation. When you do the application, you have just registered yourself into an entrance of a glorious living. So until we apply the kingdom, we are still far from the glory. Number five. Principle, I say, kingdom application will demand a personal responsibility. Taking personal responsibility, owning up and willing to practice the word, with the guidance of the Holy Spirit diligently. I said kingdom application demands Taking a personal responsibility. First of all, owning up. Owning up. Accepting your message. And willing to look into the face of your message. And take practical steps to be delivered out of your troubles. Getting rid of blame games. Getting out of excuses. Forgetting about who to blame or where you are. Blaming of who has not helped you. Avoiding blaming of who has been the trouble of where you are. We must get out of all forms of excuses. I'm only black. I wish I was not born at such a time as this. We must take responsibility and own up whatever we need to own up and be willing to practice the word if we are to manifest the glory of God. Days of excuses are gone. Days of finding who to blame or where we are. Days of pride are gone. If you lost your parents, it's okay. Move on with life. If you lost that job, glory be to God. Move on to the next life. If they are put out of the house, find another one. Jesus said, to leave them cast out of the house, God will be your own. So,
Opportunities.
Meeting prepared people at an opportune time. When you are not prepared for anything, even when opportunities come, you never
make
a mistake. So prepare yourself. In every area of your life, prepare yourself in finances, in prayer, in family life, in every kind of natural. Prepare yourself. Opportunities or chances will meet under the prepare. Now, preparation will demand you some energy. Preparation will prepare some effort. Preparation will demand you some vigorous exercises. Preparation. Sometimes it's going to demand you to stay until late when everybody is asleep. Preparation will demand you to stay awake while everyone is asleep. A student who will succeed in their exams, they prepare until late in the night. If you don't prepare for the exams, it does not matter how smart you are, you will fail. A good lawyer
won't
be able to handle a case and be able to excel in a case. Before they present their presentation,
the
night before, they will prepare vigorously. Recently, Uganda medics, the medical doctors of Mulago Hospital, a portion of medical doctors in Mulago, they carried out a successful cardiac operation. A heart operation. Now, normally in Uganda, they take all the heart patients to India.
Uganda, and
you have to pay probably from 50 to 100 plus million shillings to do a heart operation. But for the first time this year, in our country, medical doctors, they did a successful heart operation, 100% successful. So today they say you don't have to take somebody to India, to Germany to do a heart operation. But when they were interviewed, they say one of the secrets of our success in this operation, ample time in preparation. They prepare their minds. They prepare their minds. They prepare their hearts. They prepared various instruments that are supposed to be used
in the theater.
They prepared all the kind of medicine and all the kind of spirits and all the kinds of gadgets they needed. They prepared. Because you don't have a lot of time when you open up a man's chest and you begin, because it's a matter of life and death. So everything must be in place
and
on time. So when you are not prepared well, somebody will end up dying in your hands. So preparation is very paramount. in order for us to meet our opportunities and moments. So I said application demands personal response. So part of the personal responsibility is in preparation. Some of the personal responsibility is owning up our messes. Sometimes for God to deliver you, you must look into his face and tell him, Lord, and accept your shortcomings. Avoid cover ups.
We
cannot pretend before God. God knows our weaknesses, God knows our failures, God knows our shortcomings. Whatever portion of your heart you don't give to God, God will never take responsibility. You can be born again and a liar. You can be a child of God and a liar. You can be a preacher and a cheat. You can call yourself a man or a woman of God, but when you are still a fornicator, an adulterer, or a liar, or a cheater. Why is it possible? Every portion, every bit of your life, you don't surrender to God, God will never take rest.
But if you sing a chamutima kujotawate katona, you touch your queen.
God is a gentleman.
Katona,
the Spirit of God is a gentleman.
For
it is only what you deliver to him,
he
will take responsibility. So taking responsibility is key. Somebody said amen. Pastor Peter, how much time do I have? 10 minutes, okay. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Maybe I tackle that tomorrow or some other day. All right. When I do another teaching, I will now show us the meaning of the word apply from the Hebrew version.
But now from you no some more Kurana,
I will handle that in the other teaching.
But
let me show you a few things in 10 minutes. What application of God's kingdom will demand. What applying God's kingdom will demand. And you must be willing to meet the terms and conditions of the demand. As long as you meet them, you
will
enjoy the growth.
Number
one demand, you need the necessary knowledge. In the area you desire change. Identify the area where you desire change. And get the necessary knowledge. The kingdom operates by knowledge. The kingdom works with knowledge. Relevant and current information. It is that knowledge that the Spirit of the Lord will translate into a revelation which will use as an avenue to be able to get where you want to
go.
Number two, be aware of the change you need. Get to know the change you need and the areas in your life where you need the change. For example, if you are tired to earn what you earn, probably you need a change in your income. So identify that my change is in the area of income. Then you'll be able to locate practical steps on how to be delivered out of
scarcity.
This kind of confusion that has been in church for so long. If you want to receive 100 million, so 1 million. If you want to get a new job, so this special offering. All those kind of foolishness must come to an end. The kingdom of God operates on principles and values, not on excitement and those weird things. So you need to identify to be aware of the change you need in your life.
For improvement and for betterment.
Four. Life is designed in the way that it is not static or stationary. The life we are living is not supposed to be static or stationary.
Once
you treat life that way, life loses meaning. That's why you can be in church and you are bored of church. You are not motivated to come to church. You are not motivated to engage in the activities of the church. You are not motivated to serve God either as an usher or in the choir. You are bored. You
feel tired.
Why?
Because
you treated life with a stationary or static mentality. To date, nobody forces me to come to church on time. Every time I look for to be in my father's house
early.
Yesterday, I think I was here before 4 in the morning. Now, the day I will come here on Sunday at 6, I will even feel guilty. That's in the morning. The day I arrive 6, I feel guilty. Why? When I go to bed, what I'm thinking about is to go to church the next day. Because why? My heart is about my father's house. Not because I'm a pastor. I've done this all my life. I remember many years ago when we were still pastoring the other church. We used to have our services at Ginger Road Police Post. This was a bar. So every Saturday, you know how they drunkards would mess up the bar, they would leave it, they waiting.
You
would
miss
the toilets and it was a horror. And on Sunday we are supposed to have a service in the morning. I was the resident pastor. And of course the bar will be covered with all sorts of advertisement of beer and stuff. I'll leave home very early still in the night, come, clean the entire place from the church sanctuary to the bathroom. I'll get pieces of cloth and cover up those liquor
adverts.
Set the church alone.
Church in India, they get up home,
put everything in order. And exactly 6,
I'll
go back home. So I will come still at a normal time like everybody. And people wonder who really cleaned the church. And it was between me and my God because of my love for God. And yet I'm doing all that. I am the resident pastor and I am going to preach on Sunday. What is the motivation of me doing that? My love for my God. My love for my Father's house. And every Saturday I would look for, it does not matter how tired I am on Saturday. By 5 I'm at church cleaning up the place. Now one time, a few brothers actually took ministers here, our missions director here.
Missions director.
And our minister in charge of security.
The minister of security.
Because they were ushers also that time.
But
so, one time they said, but who cleaned this church? Every Sunday, we are ushers, but the time we come, all our work is done. So this time they didn't tell me. So they said, let's try to come a bit early. So by 5:30, they were around. And they followed me around. They said,
hey.
Okay.
Okay.
They didn't tell me nothing. The following Sunday.
Sunday, yes, therefore.
Before I came at 5. That is the day I stopped ushering.
I will nakoma away.
Leaders lead by example. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. So church must be the most exciting thing. If we embrace possible change, our lives need to constantly change. For better, for greater, and for improvement. But how does change come? By daily applying the kingdom of God. When you don't apply the kingdom, you'll be bored. You live a double standard, and you live it
daily.
Have you been blessed today? Just bow your head and let's talk to the Lord. Just talk to the Lord in the
minute.
Father, we thank you.
That
help us to love your kingdom, to restore the dignity of the kingdom, and the glory of the kingdom. Help us to apply your kingdom. Father, I pray that from this time henceforth, this summit is officially opened up. I declare your glory. I declare your power. I set apart this place. I set apart a pulpit. I pray that whoever will stand here will connect with the mind of the Spirit. Will connect with the mind of Christ. That life will flow from this mountain. Rivers will flow from this mountain. And affect every bit and every life. In the name of Jesus. We declare your kingdom come. Your will be done. In the name of Jesus. Father, bless you in Jesus' mighty name. Ladies and gentlemen, we declare the Empowerment Summit of the 7th edition official open this morning.
By
the grace of God, in Jesus' mighty name. God bless you.
Thank you.